Well, good morning, Second Story. How are you guys doing? Awesome. Hey, if you don't know me, my name's Tabby, and I'm really excited to be here today, and I'm excited that I get to share on this very first Sunday of our new church. And listen, we are going on a new journey, and we want to invite you to come along with us. We need you here. We want you. So whether you're in person or online, we invite you along on our new journey. And we're so thankful, like Pastor Seth just said, we're so thankful for Free Grace United and the journey we've been on. But we're ready for the next. We're ready for the new. And next week, we're actually starting a new series called Unleashed. And it's going to talk a lot about the church and what the church should be and what the church should look like and the people that we should be if we are claiming to be followers of Jesus. So that starts next week. Make sure you're here. It's going to be great. I've already seen a little bit of what we're going to do, and it's really exciting. I'm excited for it. But today we're doing a standalone message. So no more John. Yeah. Well, you should be sad. John's a great book. You should be sad. Okay. No more John. Today we're doing a standalone message. And as we start our new journey, I thought it would make sense for us to talk about a time in the Bible where some people were starting on a new journey of their own. So we're going to put it up here. If you have your Bibles on your phones or in person, you can look at them. We're going to read from Exodus 13 today. It says this: when Pharaoh finally let the people go, God did not lead them along the main road that runs through the Philistine territory, even though that was the shortest route to the Promised Land. God said, if the people are faced with a battle, they might change their minds and return to Egypt. So God led them in a roundabout way through the wilderness toward the Red Sea. Thus the Israelites left Egypt like an army ready for battle. Jumping down to verse 20, the Israelites left Succoth. I think they should probably have left Succoth. I think that was a good choice. The Israelites left Succoth and camped at Etham on the edge of the wilderness. Verse 21, the Lord went ahead of them. He guided them during the day with a pillar of cloud, and he provided light at night with a pillar of fire. This allowed them to travel by day or by night, and the Lord did not remove the pillar of cloud or pillar of fire from its place in front of the people. The title of my message today is Ever Present. Would you pray with me? Jesus, we thank you so much for this day. We rejoice in it. We thank you for Second Story Church. We thank you for the new path we're on. And we pray that in these next few moments, that your word would accomplish what it needs to accomplish. I pray that you would anoint my mouth to speak the words you want to speak, to share hope, to share peace, to share promise. God, we thank you that you never give up on us. We thank you that you are always with us. We trust you to do what only you can do this morning and beyond. In your name we pray. Amen. Now, how many of you would say that you're a relatively patient person? See your hands. Relatively patient? Okay, a few of you are pretty bold, and the people next to you are looking at you like, no, put it down. Stop lying, especially in church. What are you even thinking? I would say, okay, and this might not, those of you that know me, you might not think this matches up with my personality, but I would actually say I'm a relatively patient person. Relatively. Like, I've got the things, you know, we've all got the things that, like, kind of set us off. Like, if I'm driving on the highway and there's, like, a Buick LeSabre in the left lane, and it's going, as all Buick LeSabres do, at 50 miles an hour. I'm sorry if you have a Buick LeSabre. I get a little bit impatient. Like, I'm like, get into the right lane. I don't care how fast you go, but get out of my way, right? Okay, I know some of you feel this way. You're looking at me like I'm a bad person, but you feel the same way, I know. Another thing, when I'm at Starbucks, like, I'm a Starbucks person. Like, I'm the kind of person that, like, my Starbucks before COVID, like, that I went to every single day, like, I'd walk in and they'd be like, hey, grande non-fat chai, are you ready? Like, I got your drink, I'm ready. Like, they already knew what I, like, was gonna order. Like, that's the kind of person I am. But when I go to Starbucks, I always end up behind the person who's never had coffee. They're just standing there like, and I'm like, they have coffee and tea. What do you want? And if you're really bold and you don't care what people think of you, I guess you can get a Frappuccino, but I wouldn't advise it. Like, just pick. Just make a choice. Like, I get pretty impatient when it comes to that. But, like, aside from those two things, there's only really one thing that I think I really lose my patience fast, and it's when I need something really desperately, and I have to wait a long time to get it. A few years ago, I was in Chicago on a girls' trip with my friend Courtney and my friend Anna. And we've been to Chicago many times together. So we kind of have like our favorite places that we like to go, like our little spots and stuff. And we had landed on a Friday night. We were just there for the weekend. And we were like, okay, we already have plans. Like the restaurant we're going to, our hotel was literally three or four blocks from that restaurant. And we were super excited. And so we started to walk over to the restaurant. And I'm thinking about like the shaved Brussels sprout salad that I love there. And I'm thinking about their fries, which are awesome. And I'm walking, and something you may not know about me is that I'm like a little bit klutzy, slightly. If you were here in December, I preached with a boot on my foot. Okay, I'm a little bit klutzy, and I wasn't looking at the ground, because who looks at the ground? I was looking ahead, and I went like this, and fell flat down, like right on my knee. And Courtney and Anna stop and look at me, and they're like, are you okay? And I'm like, oh yeah, yeah. So I get up, and I'm like, I am not okay. Like, I'm thinking, like, I don't even know how I'm gonna walk there, but I'm trying to be really calm because I don't wanna, like, ruin our trip. It's literally the first 30 minutes of our trip. It's like, I don't wanna ruin it. So we're walking to the restaurant, and I sit down, and my knee is hurting so bad, I feel nauseous. And I'm like, I think I need to go to the bathroom. So I get up, and I go to the bathroom, and I check my knee out, and it's, like, gushing blood. Like, my jeans are stained. I'm a little bit concerned that I need stitches, but I'm definitely not getting stitches out of network, so whatever, it's gonna have to do, it's gonna have to be what it is. And I'm like, oh! And so, you know, I go back to the table and Courtney looks at me with that look, like, I know it's bad. And I know you're not telling me because you know you're gonna make me mad. You know, I know it's bad. And so I sit there and I try to get through the meal and I'm like, you know, eating, and then I like look up at them and I'm like, you guys, I gotta go pack. I'm in so much pain, and my, like, I can feel the blood still running down my leg. Like, I had put some toilet paper to try to stop it, but like, it didn't really work. And so they're like, well, okay, go back to the hotel. We will stop at Walgreens on the way back. We'll get some supplies for your knee. It'll all be okay. And I'm like, okay, great. So like, I can't even walk the three blocks back to the hotel. So I literally have to take an Uber three blocks. I mean, that guy probably hated me. Like, I have to take an Uber because it's so bad, I'm like seriously going like this. And so I take an Uber, I get back to the hotel, I like lay on the bed, I elevate, you know, I'm trying to stop the bleeding, and I'm waiting. And I'm waiting for them to show up, and I keep waiting. And I'm like, okay, we were halfway through our meal when I left, like, what's going on? And I keep waiting, and I'm like texting Courtney, like, hey, what's going on? You know, like, not trying not to be too irritating, but also like, I need you here now. Because, like, I need this stuff. And finally, after what seemed like forever, they got back to the hotel. And I looked at them and I was like, you guys, like, what, where were you? And they were like, oh, we ran into the Cavaliers. And I was like from Cleveland? Like the Cleveland Cavaliers? And they were like, yeah, I think they're in town. And I said, you ran into LeBron James, like the second best basketball player of all time? I was like, you ran into the, and they were like, yeah, we don't even know. We're not even sure. And they were like, who's LeBron James? And I was like, you guys, you literally were by LeBron James and you didn't even know. And they were like, yeah, they like had blocked off the hotel and there were like all these girls waiting around and like all these people were walking and we had to kind of like walk around them and get there. And I'm like, okay, so you ran into the Cavaliers. I guess that's a valid excuse for like why it took you so long to get back to me. I didn't enjoy it, but eventually I got the supplies. It was all good. In our text today, we are also looking at a group of people who had to take the long way, who had to circumvent their operation or their plan from what they had thought. And even though this story that I read from Exodus 13 was thousands of years ago, it happened a long time ago, there's still parallels to our stories today. And there are truths for us to apply to our lives. Pastor Tim Keller, who you should be familiar with if you're not, because he's brilliant, he says, the purpose of Bible study is not to figure out like, oh, how is this gonna make me feel? It's to say, what is God saying in this passage? And what does this passage tell us about who God is? And if that's true, then how do I live? And so as we go into this passage today and we dive a little bit deeper into Exodus 13, I want you to be thinking of that. What does this tell me about who God is? And then if that's true, how should I live my life? Let's look back at verse 17. It reminds us of this. God did not lead them along the main road that runs through Philistine territory, even though that was the shortest route to the promised land. It was the shortest route, but God didn't lead them that way. My first point is this: God did not lead them among the most logical path. See, I don't know if you're familiar with the story of the Israelites in Egypt, but they were slaves for hundreds of years. And God had promised them that there's a land of freedom and wholeness and joy for you, and I'm going to take you there someday. But they continued to be slaves day after day. And all the way back in Exodus 3, God calls Moses, who is like kind of a nobody and kind of like does some bad things. He calls Moses and he says, I want you to lead my people out of Egypt, out of slavery, into the promised land. And it's very dramatic. If you went to Sunday school or if you ever watched The Prince of Egypt or Ten Commandments or something, you probably know about the plagues and the locusts and the gross blood, water, and all this stuff. Like, it was pretty dramatic. So you'd think God was trying to get them out of there fast, and he was going to get them into the promised land fast. But this verse actually tells us that he didn't lead them along the main road, even though that was the shortest route. See, there was a direct route, there was a short route, but God didn't lead them that way. And see, when you start to seriously follow God, when you give your life to him and you say, I'm committed to following you, you might kind of be surprised that sometimes the moves he makes or the way the road curves or turns, the way he takes you, is not the most logical path. Have you found that to be true? Like, there's some things in my life that I think, okay, A plus B equals C, and it all makes sense. And God's like, oh, no. A plus C plus X plus Y plus D equals my promise. And if you're a person like me who likes order and plans, it can drive you crazy. But the reality is, even though God didn't put them on the shortest path, he put them on the path to promise. Even though it wasn't the path that would make sense to them in the natural mind, he put them on the path that actually was going to bring them to the place they needed to be. So if you're following God, when you truly decide to surrender your life, when you truly decide to follow, get ready to follow along a path that might not make sense to you. See, I think some of us get so stuck, and maybe even today, you're so stuck because the path that God is leading you on isn't logical. It doesn't fit in your framework. It doesn't really make sense with your life plan. You know, I always think it's funny. I've never had children, and so I want to say this very carefully, but I have a lot of friends that have, and you know, they all have a birth plan. This is my birth plan. I'm going all natural. Kudos to you. And then it's like, oh no, I did not go all natural. Okay, my birth plan, nope. Whether we like to admit it or not, we kind of have a life plan. And we kind of expect that following God is just going to make our life plan a little bit easier. Like, we're just going to be able to walk right through. But actually, following God takes us on a curvy path that doesn't always make sense. And sometimes it's a path that can make you stop and say, what are you doing? What are you doing, God? And so today, if you're stuck, I want to encourage you. The path that God leads his children on is never the path of least resistance. So if you're standing and looking at your life and thinking, this doesn't quite add up, it doesn't quite make sense, or like, God, I think you're kind of leading me to do this, to step out in this way, to join this church, to do this ministry, to start this business, to do this thing that I wasn't really planning on doing quite yet, I want to remind you, God did not lead the children of Israel along the most logical path, and he still does not lead us along the most logical path. But the good news is, the path he leads us on is a path to the promised land. It just doesn't look like what we think it should look like. And I can just see them. I mean, can't you see these people? Like, they have been in slavery for generations. And they're like, finally, we're gone. Finally, we're going to get to go to that place that I've heard about my whole life that I thought was like Never Never Land. Like, finally, we're moving to the promised land. And God says, actually, not so fast. You know that road, like, that takes you through the Philistine territory, that really quick way to get there? Actually, I'm going to take you around. I'm going to take you around. And I could just imagine even Moses, God giving Moses this plan of like, okay, Moses, I want you to lead the people this way. And I could just imagine him thinking, oh, no. I gotta go tell them this? Like, after all this, we're gonna spend more time in this wilderness? But see, I can also imagine that in that moment, God was trying to convey a message to them and saying, actually, leading you along the least logical path deepens your trust in me. It deepens your faith in who I am. It produces a deeper willingness for you to listen to my voice, a deeper commitment on your part to move forward no matter what the cost. It produces a deeper desire for the promised land. From the beginning of this journey, trust was required. From the beginning, trust was required. And just like the Israelites in Exodus 13, trust is required for us. In every area of our lives, on a large scale as our church, as we move out into this new season, the Second Story Church, trust is required. It doesn't all make sense. It's maybe not the most logical thing to try to launch a church in 3 weeks. But God's path to promise is not our path to promise. Trust is required. See, if you're going to live this life of faith, you're going to have to be willing to trust God. Because God didn't take them on the most logical path. Well, why not? My second point here is God led them in a roundabout way for their good. Let's look back to verse 17. God said this, if the people are faced with a battle, they might change their minds and return to Egypt. So God led them in a roundabout way through the wilderness toward the Red Sea. Thus, the Israelites left Egypt like an army ready for battle. See, this text actually tells us that it was God's grace that kept them from the shortest, most logical path. Because what God knew that they didn't know was that they were not prepared to fight the battles they'd have to face on that quick road. What God knew that they didn't know was that there were Philistines and they did not have slingshots and stones. They were not prepared to fight the battle that was ahead of them. And so God said, in my grace and because I love you, I'm going to take you on this roundabout path that's going to protect you from what you can't handle. And so it is with us today. It was his grace that took them the long way. And in his provision, he kept them from a path that might have caused them to turn back and to go back to where they've been, to go back into slavery, to go back to the old way of living. See, they didn't know, but God did. So he led them in this crazy roundabout long way for their good. See, what we can't forget here is that God actually called them. So they're in the wilderness. They're not in the wilderness because of sin. They're in the wilderness because God called them out of Egypt, and he called them through a wilderness, which, to be honest, is probably not that desirable. It's like, can I go from this horrible land to the special land? No, you're going to actually spend some time in the wilderness. So don't think today, if you are in a wilderness season, or if you're in a season where you're like, I don't even know if God's there, I don't even know if God cares, I don't even know if God loves me. Don't let the devil tempt you into believing that because you're in a wilderness, you're not following God. Because quite often, following him leads you to places that you would never go yourself. And leads you to do things that you would never do yourself. See, God called them, but they still had to walk. God called them, but they still had to obey. See, because they went the roundabout way, some things changed for them. Let's look back at verse 18. It actually says this. So God led them in a roundabout way through the wilderness towards the Red Sea. This is the part I want you to catch. Thus, the Israelites left Egypt like an army ready for battle. What changed? Because just a minute ago, we read that they couldn't go through the Philistine way because they'd probably turn back. But it says here, they left like an army. What took them from meek to army in a matter of seconds? Obedience. They obeyed what God told them to do, and instantly their trajectory changed, and instantly their identity was strengthened. Instantly, there was a change because they obeyed. And I want to tell you today, God cares about obedience. I know this is not like the kind of thing we love to talk about because it's really not always fun, but God cares about obedience. It's all through the Bible. If you read the Bible, you're going to see many times where people did not fulfill their destiny. They did not live up to their potential. They did not have all that they could have had simply because they chose not to obey. And to be honest, the Israelites did their share of sinning, and they had a lot of disobedience, and that's a whole different sermon. But in this thing, as they left Egypt, they obeyed. And as they obeyed, verse 18 tells us, when they left, they became like an army because they chose to walk in obedience. And I want to encourage you today, God cares about your obedience, and God led them, but yes, they had to obey, and so do we. How do we obey? I have a couple ideas. One, know the Word of God. You have to know the Bible. If all of your exposure to the Bible is like this hour, that's really not gonna do it. Read the Bible, get to study scripture, get to know God. That's one of the best reasons why, one of the best ways that you can actually obey him is if you know him and know what he's asking of you. A second thing is seek out the counsel of godly advisors. Godly advisors. So listen, when I make a big decision, I don't make it on my own. Even if I feel like God is leading me, I believe the Bible shows us time and time again that in an abundance of counselors, there is wisdom. And so I go to godly people in my life, people that are like my age, people that are younger than me, and people that are many decades older than me, and say, this is what I feel like God's speaking. What are your thoughts? Can you pray with me about it? Can you believe with me for this? Seek godly wisdom. It helps you learn to obey. The last piece of advice for how can we actually obey when we feel like God's calling us to move forward, ignore culture. Oh, I mean, I could talk about this for a really long time, but I'll try to be very brief. We have a culture right now of meme theology. All you have to do is be on Facebook or Instagram very quickly, and you're going to see people bashing the church, talking about how people have hurt them, so therefore Jesus can't be who he was, talking about preacher sneakers, all kinds of stuff that's actually not valuable to the kingdom and actually has nothing to do with theology. And you have influencers and bloggers and all kinds of crazy people that are trying to write off Christianity by posting something online, by creating a meme that kind of feels good. Listen, you have to use discernment. Because here's the reality. If your Christianity looks a lot like the culture that we live in right now, you're not living biblical Christianity. If the way that you follow Jesus is by feeling like, okay, well, I feel good about God. I think God loves me, so I'm going to move forward. No, you're not living biblical Christianity because, again, he does not take us on the path we want. If all of your desires, if all of your appetites are fulfilled with the way you're living your Christianity, you are not living biblical Christianity. I can only imagine Jesus like telling the disciples 2,000 years ago, hey, this is how I want you to live, and this is how you're supposed to treat other people, and this is what it means to be sexually pure, and this is what it means to be godly, and this is what it means to be kind. But by the way, in 2020, there's going to be a blogger that's going to write a really interesting article about sexual ethics, and you can believe that, because that's when my truth will be revealed. It's not here and now. Listen, if you want to follow Jesus, a requirement is that you obey what he says. And the way to know what he says is not to find out what your favorite blogger, Instagram person says. It's actually to find it in his word. That's free. Okay, here we go. Moving along. See, they moved from a meek people, a people that were likely to give up, to an army. Simply because they were willing to trust God, they were willing to walk in obedience to him. And listen, the good news for you today is if you are following Jesus with your whole heart, you don't have to be perfect, but if you're following him with your whole heart, you are on a path to promise. You are on that path to promise, even if it doesn't look like what you thought. But see, just because you start on that path doesn't mean you arrive. Obedience is a must. And if you're following Jesus, no matter where the path leads you, you can have confidence that you will go from strength to strength, from victory to victory. 1 Corinthians 15:57. Listen, you might have pain. Not everything is going to work out exactly how you want. I can't promise you that this church is going to work out exactly how you want, but what I can tell you is that God will take us from place to place in victory for his glory and for our good. God called them to the roundabout path for their good. On this faith journey, trust is required. Because when you start to follow this roundabout path, it's really easy to get disoriented. But stay true to who God is. Continue to seek him. Continue to read his word. Continue to seek godly counsel. Continue to listen to those that you trust. Continue to spend time in his presence. And as you do that, you will see him move you from place to place in victory. See, it's interesting because God actually took them through the wilderness and toward the Red Sea. Now, I don't know how much they knew. I don't know if they knew they were going to the Red Sea or not, but regardless, the wilderness is not the ideal spot for a journey. Scholars think there was probably about 1 million people that were on this journey, okay? 1 million people on a roundabout path towards a sea, not great. Not great. And by the way, this sea was 190 feet wide and 9,000 feet deep. To the natural human eye, this was not a promising path. This was an illogical path, but in the spirit realm, this was the path to promise because it was the path that God had ordained. And even though it was the long and the roundabout way, and even they had no idea where they were going or why, they chose to trust when they could have chosen resentment. They chose to trust even though it probably wasn't looking great because they knew who was leading them. I want to remind you, don't think just because you're going through a wilderness that your promise is gone. Your promise is not gone. You may not see the thing that you've been asking God for. You may not see that baby or that job or that spouse or that breakthrough, but just because it's out of your sight, I want to remind you, it can be out of your sight, but it's still in God's hands. It can be out of your sight, but it's still in God's hands. He can be trusted. He led them in a roundabout way for their good. Let's look at verse 20. It says this, the Israelites left Succoth and camped at Etham on the edge of the wilderness. The third thing I want us to think about here is that they didn't use the wilderness as an excuse, but as motivation. They didn't say, well, you led me to this wilderness, so now I'm ticked. And I'm just going to sit here, and I'm going to sit in this camp, and we'll just see what you can do. They still got up and moved to a new camp. And then the next day, moved to a new camp. They still moved forward. See, they could have used it as an excuse or a reason not to trust, but they didn't. And listen, I've already said it. They did their fair share of complaining. They did their fair share of sinning. But even though they were in the wilderness and the promised land of Canaan was nowhere in sight, the scripture tells us that they continued to move on. And listen, we got a lot of people, and some of you might even be here today, who stop when you get to the wilderness, who stop when you get to the place of pain. And I just want to say something really quick. Pain is real. And here at Second Story, we don't deny it. We don't deny that life is hard. I don't sit here and make light of your pain. But I also want to encourage you, you can't live your life based on your pain. Because if you do, you're going to get stuck. And there is story after story of people getting stuck on their pain, stopping when they were supposed to move forward. They stop, and that's where they die. Because you have the choice when you're faced with pain. Yes, I believe you should get healing from your pain. Yes, forgive the person that hurt you. Yes, go to a counselor. I love counseling personally. I love going to counseling. It's great. Yes, do what you need to do for your mental health. But don't use that as an excuse to sit in your pain. Listen, I know people that had some really serious church hurt like 6 or 7 years ago and have still not returned back to church. And let me tell you, there are times when you may have to take a season where you're like, I gotta sit, I gotta heal, I gotta rest. I've been there myself. But let me tell you that, if that season becomes your norm, that is a problem. And it's not just with this, with church, it's with anything. Yes, I've been hurt by pastors. I've been hurt by people that said they were Christians. I've been hurt by bosses. I've been hurt by friends. But you know what? You have to get up and keep moving. You can use it as an excuse, and then that's what you sit in for the rest of your life. Or you can use it as motivation to keep moving forward, to say, God, I don't get it, I don't like it, but I choose to trust you. But I choose to go ahead. See, we got a lot of people that want to be a victim. And they would never admit that, but it kind of feels good when we're hurting because we get attention. We get some of the things that we've been lacking. And I just want you to know that you don't have to live that way to live a fulfilled life where you are loved and seen. That's why we have the church. So we can love and see you and love you back to health and love you back to wholeness. But the process is hard. Last fall, I broke my foot. And my foot has been better, you know, for a month or a couple months, it's been better. But I will tell you something that I just recently started, like a week and a half ago, as I started working out again. And I have to be honest with you, it's kind of overwhelming to me. Not just because, you know, when you work out regularly and then you stop, you like lose all your fitness, right? Anyone been there? No, just me, okay, great. Not just because of that, because when you have broken something and it hurts, and you feel that pain, it gets hard mentally. It feels hard emotionally. It's hard to have the courage to go back and exercise that thing that was broken and say, you know what, you were broken, but you're not stopping. You were broken, but you're gonna move again. You were broken, but you're gonna learn to run again. You were broken, but you're gonna learn how to lift weights again. It's hard, but it's necessary. Because if I never worked out again because I broke my foot in 2020, we can all probably agree that wouldn't be the most healthy way to live life. Even though they didn't know how they crossed the Red Sea, they knew they were heading towards it, they knew it was gonna be kind of overwhelming, and I can only imagine some of them were thinking, we're probably gonna die here. They didn't know how they'd cross it, but they continued to move forward. Mother Teresa said this. Someone asked her a question about, like, how did you get clarity on, like, your call and on, you know, what you're supposed to do with your life? And she said, I've never had clarity. What I've had is trust. You may not have clarity about the best next step, but what you can have is trust. And because you can have trust, you can move forward. Because you can have trust, you can heal from the pain that hurt you. Because you have trust, you can forgive the person that did the unforgivable, because you know that God will do so much more with your life if you will just come to him and follow him and obey. If you are following Jesus, you are on the path to promise. Because even when you're heading to the Red Sea, it's not the end. It's not the end. See, I want to ask you today, what if your wilderness place is actually just a stop on the path to promise? What if your wilderness place is a punishment from God? What if your wilderness place isn't the place you have to live? What if God's actually saying, I know who hurt you. I know what they did. And I'm sorry, but you are no longer a victim. Now you are a victor. I want to encourage you, if you're stuck in the wilderness today, if you're not using it as motivation, but you are using it as an excuse, I want to encourage you to make your healer bigger than your wounder. Because it's really easy to make the wounder the biggest thing in our lives. Well, I'm this. Well, I had this. So I blank. You know what? Let's stop it. Let's make our healer the biggest thing. Because what we see when we look to the Word time and time and time again is that he is faithful, he can be trusted, he restores. That's actually why we chose this name. It's not because it's cute. It's not even because Pastor Seth likes it, although I think he does like it. It's not even because of that. It's because there is a reality that no matter what has happened in your story, there is a new and glorious and promised land for you to get to, and we want to help you get there. And there is a truth that the God who loves you so very much will never leave you. And that's my last point. They were never alone. And listen, I've been through some things. And sometimes when I can look at my life and say, where were you to God? But when I really stop and think, I see his hand. I see his protection. I see his providence. I see his comfort. I see his love. And if you don't know that today because you've never really experienced those things from God, I want to invite you. You can experience them. It's not for super spiritual or super elite or people that are really good at church. It's for anybody. It's for all. It's for all who are thirsty. You are not alone. You are not alone. Let's look at verse 21. The Lord went ahead of them. He guided them during the day with a pillar of cloud and provided light at the night with a pillar of fire. This allowed them to travel by day or by night, and the Lord did not remove the pillar of cloud or pillar of fire from its place in front of the people. See, in the middle of the wilderness, as they were licking their wounds from hundreds of years of slavery and captivity, as they were no doubt full of fear, as they were heading towards a very large sea with a lot of people, with their enemies chasing after them, he was there. He was ever present. He was a pillar of cloud, it says, in the day, and a pillar of fire at night. That means, it's very weird, I get it, but it means his manifest presence, like the presence of God himself, came down and protected the Israelites. It was a cloud to protect them in the day, and it was a fire by night so they could see where they were going. They were insulated and they were illuminated. They were protected and they were prepared because they were not alone. And listen, they may not have known what was ahead of them, but they did know who was ahead of them. And just like them, you may not know what's ahead of you. And sometimes it might really be scary what's ahead of you. Maybe you do know, and you're like, I don't know how I'm going to face it. You don't have to figure out how, because you can know who is ahead of you. Because the word says he goes before. Every path you walk, he has walked. You are not alone. We're here for you. You are not alone. Because they committed to trust in the beginning of the journey, they were able to trust now. Even as they were heading towards the Red Sea, they were able to trust. They were able to move forward because they knew who was going ahead of them. The text says they could travel by day or by night, which means no matter what the circumstance was, no matter what the weather was like, no matter what the sand was like, no matter what was happening in the natural, they had supernatural guidance and provision. No matter what was in front of them or what was against them, they were not alone. And so it is with you and with me. No matter who is against us or what is against us, no matter what statistics are against us, no matter what our bank account looks like, no matter what our relationships look like, no matter how addicted we may be today, you are not alone. And if you're not alone, it means that the Redeemer and the Restorer is carrying you with him. And he is going to take you to a land of promise. Because no matter what your story has been like so far, if you're following Jesus, all of our stories end with him. All of our stories end in heaven, where there is no more where there is no more pain and there are no more tears. And so no matter what your path looks like, no matter how difficult it's been, I want you to know that if you are following him, you are on a path to promise. And you are not alone. Our God is close to the brokenhearted, and he saves those whose spirits are crushed. Psalm 46 says this: God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in times of trouble. Therefore, we will not fear when the earth gives way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea. Though its waters roar and foam, and the mountains quake with their surging. The psalmist is saying, bring it on. I know who my God is. I know I'm going to go through some stuff. But listen, he is an ever-present help in times of trouble. So I will not fear. And I want to tell you that as true as that was then, it is true today. I don't know what's ahead of you, but I know who is ahead of you. And so you can live with confidence and joy and boldness and hope, knowing that God is your ever-present help in times of trouble. When you're the lowest, he's the closest. I'm going to ask the worship team to come up. There's another scripture I want to share with you. It's Isaiah 41, verse 10, and it says this. So do not fear. This is a theme. Do not fear. Do not be dismayed, or another word for that is discouraged. For I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous hand. Listen, today, no matter what, you can be strengthened, you can be upheld, you can move forward without fear, because the same God who led the Israelites along the path of promise says in his word that he does not change. He's faithful forever. We sang about it today. Great is his faithfulness. His faithfulness will never leave you. It'll never leave me. He's an ever-present help in times of trouble, an ever-trustworthy guide in times of darkness. No matter how difficult your situation is today, I'm not downplaying it. I know that in this room there's a lot of broken hearts. In this room there's a lot of broken dreams. And in this room there's a lot of hopeful people who just have a little bit of fear of the future. It's okay. But I want to encourage you, don't stay there. Bring it to God. Bring it to him. As I close, I want to share a story from Luke chapter 5. And if you joined us for The Chosen, you saw this up close. It's one of my favorite stories in the Bible. Peter. You've probably heard of Peter. He's a fisherman. He hasn't met Jesus yet. And he's fishing all night. This is how he makes money. This is how he feeds his family. This is his livelihood. And he catches nothing. And Jesus shows up on the shore and says, hey! And this is like the next morning. So, you know, imagine Peter's like exhausted, ticked off, hasn't made any money, ready to go home and sleep, probably hungry. Jesus stands on the shore and says, hey, I got an idea. Throw your net to the other side. I can only imagine Peter being like, I got an idea. You're a carpenter. I'm a fisherman. Shut up. Right? It was illogical. It actually didn't make sense. It was kind of a ridiculous request. Like, okay, I didn't think of that one. Okay. But Peter's response is one that I hope I have in my life, and I hope you have it in your life. When God gives you a path that's not logical, when he takes you on a roundabout way, Peter's response was this, but because you said so, I'll do it. Because you said so, I don't know why you're calling me to do this, but you said so, so I'll move forward. I don't know why you're not giving me the thing that I've been praying for, but you called me to go and sow a seed into this, and so I'm going to move forward because you said so. And when Peter threw the net to the other side, so many fish filled the net that he had to have another boat come and help him reel in the catch. I remember about 8 years ago, ten-ish, we'll say. I graduated my master's degree in education. And while I was in grad school, I got a job in ministry, and I actually hated it. And I was like, I don't ever want to do this again. And I come from a ministry family, so I was for sure like, nope, not doing that. Got my master's in education. I got into educational administration kind of by default. And I was moving up very quickly in my career. I was a dean of students at a college, and I was on a great trajectory. I had a great, like, financial outlook. It was all really great. And then I started to feel this kind of stirring in my heart where God was saying, why don't you go intern at your church? And I'm like, okay, number one, I'm like in a career, so no thank you. Number two, I'm almost 30 years old. All of our interns were like 20. No. Number three, I already know ministry. That's all I did growing up. And number four, I don't want anything to do with it. Thanks. But once again, I went to the godly council in my life. And I said, this is crazy. Like, it's not logical. It doesn't make sense. But I feel like God's calling me to do this. And they said, I think he is. So I did the most, like, stupid thing I could possibly think to do at the age of 30 on a career path that I loved. And I went and interned at my church for free for, like, 20 hours a week. And then a year later, I felt God say, I want you to give up your job. I want you to give up your salary. I want you to give up your career path and your trajectory. And I want you to go into ministry. And I really fought with that for a while. But I eventually got to that Peter moment where I said, because you said so. I don't want to, but because you said so. And I was in ministry, and I, in that time, experienced such awesome things and actually discovered, like, things that I think are reasons I'm alive on the earth. Like, I never had that, but I felt like I found that in ministry. And I was kind of, like, actually moving along and getting promoted in ministry pretty quickly. And then, kind of like that, that was pulled out from under me. And so then I, here, have given up my career where I could have been. And now I've lost this ministry thing that I did because he said so. And it wasn't logical, and it was a very hard season. But let me tell you something. Out of the wilderness comes the promise. Because in the next 5 years, which is the last 5 years of my life, I have experienced the goodness and faithfulness of God in ways that I honestly can't describe without feeling embarrassed. I'm just going to be honest with you. If you came and talked to me one-on-one, I could tell you story after story after story. And some of it's been illogical. Like, how did I get a job at a company when I had never had any corporate experience and I came from a church? I don't know, but it changed my life and it was amazing. Why did I respond to a DM that Pastor Seth sent me on Instagram last October to come help him with a church plant? I don't know, but it's changed my life and it's been amazing. It's not always logical, but God leads you from place to place in victory. I'm going to ask you to stand with me. And we're going to pray two prayers, and then I'm going to ask the worship team just to sing the bridge of that last song we sang, and then we will move on with the service. But I always do this when I preach because I don't know where you're at with God, and I don't know, those of you that are online, where you're at. And some of you might be thinking, I love this idea of a path to promise. I love this idea of being able to trust and look forward and look ahead, but I'm not on a journey with God. Or I tried a journey with God, but I got hurt and I quit. Or I tried a journey with God and I failed, and so I feel like I'm not good enough. You're welcome. You're accepted. You're invited. I'm going to pray a prayer, and I'm going to ask everyone in the audience to repeat after me. And this is a simple prayer. It's a biblical prayer where we confess with our mouths that Jesus is Lord. And as we do that, if you mean it, if you want a new life, you can have it. If you want to be put on a path to promise today, you can be. Repeat this prayer with me, and if you share this prayer and you mean it, God is going to completely give you a new life. It doesn't mean an easy life, but it means a new life. Let's pray. Repeat after me. Jesus, we confess that you are Lord. We confess that we on our own are sinful. We need your help. Forgive us of our sin. Make us new. Show us what a second story can look like. In your name. The last prayer I want to pray is a prayer for those of you that feel like you're in that season of a wilderness, or you feel like you're on that illogical path and it's just been a struggle. Oh, God turns all things for good. Even the worst moment of your life, he can turn for good. It doesn't mean it won't hurt, but it means it will matter. So if you're in the place of a wilderness, you're in the place of that curvy path that you don't get, you're in a place where you feel like, I just can't trust you anymore. You're hurt. I'm just going to ask you, I'm not going to look, I'm going to ask you just to lift your hand to heaven, and I'm going to pray a simple prayer, and then I'm leaving the platform and we're going to sing. Because I believe God is still a healer, still a restorer, still a guide. And so he will lead you into all truth, and he will renew what's broken if you let him. So if that's you, I'm going to pray. Lift up your hand to God just so he sees it. Again, I'm not looking. Jesus, you see our hands. You know our hearts. You see our pain.